Good evening, everyone. So welcome to, this is one of our events in our collaborative of our three parishes for the Year of Mercy. As you know, Pope Francis declared this to be a year for mercy, and we've had a number of events. Mother Olga spoke at one event. We had the Lift Ministries event. And this, tonight, I'm going to give a talk about an encyclical that was written by St. John Paul the Great in 1980. And the encyclical is called Divis in Misericordia, which means rich in mercy. So, can you hear me back there?
Not well.
All right, let me just turn the microphone up a little bit. Can you hear me now? Okay. So, we'll just begin with a prayer in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. St. John Paul II, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, so this is just going to be kind of a lecture. I don't know how entertaining I'll be, but I'll try to keep your attention. So this encyclical was written by Pope John Paul II in 1980. And every time he wrote an encyclical letter, it always took place in the context of whatever was going on in the world. So take yourself back in time to 1980. And what do we have going on? We've got the Cold War, right? We've got the Soviet Union that is considered a terrible threat to the U.S. and to other parts of the world, to Poland especially. You know, Poland is very interesting because they were invaded by the Nazis, and then they were liberated by the Soviets. But that liberation wasn't much of a liberation. And the common thread between what the Nazis did to Poland and what the communists did was a failure to respect the dignity of the human person. And John Paul II lived through that as a young man and also as Pope. And that really affected his understanding of his mission as a Pope. He felt that it was his mission to bring the world to come to this great respect for the dignity of each individual human being. Because, you know, the Nazis had collided with the communists. They were like two different ideologies opposed to one another, but they had the same end result, which was a trampling of human dignity. Anyway, so you got the Cold War going on. You got all kinds of difficulties in the world. So many different things were going on in the world at the time, kind of like today, right? And John Paul II decides in 1980, about two years after becoming the Pope, to write this encyclical called Rich in Mercy, Divis in Misericordia. And I'm just going to go to parts of this letter. It's actually probably, I think, the shortest encyclical he wrote, which makes me very glad I picked this one to speak on, because some of them are like this big, you know? This one's only like this thick. So, but it's very profound. So, the beginning of the letter focuses on what John Paul calls the revelation of the Father's mercy in Jesus. And he says in this letter that humanity, or each individual human person, cannot be understood without reference to God in Christ. All right, so sometimes we try to understand what human life is all about, but John Paul is saying that we can't understand humanity in its fullness without reference to God. You might be able to get by for a little while pretending as if God does not exist, but it's not reality. God made us. We're made in God's image and likeness. So he always had this understanding that the human person has a special place in the plan of God, but God also needs to have a special place in the plan of humanity. So that's how he begins, the revelation of the Father's mercy in Christ. He says, as we know, that men and women can perceive the existence of God in creation. So if you look around at the world and see the beauty and the order in the world and the whole universe, you can come to a sort of awareness, kind of a limited awareness, that there is an intelligent design to everything, that there is a higher power that has ordered everything. When you think of like the way the solar system works with the sun in the center, the planets rotating around it, it's similar in design to the smallest things such as molecules and atoms. They have like a center and something goes around them. So you see like a certain order to creation. Well, John Paul II says that the existence and the mercy of God is revealed fully in Jesus Christ. So that's what Jesus does. Jesus comes to reveal God to us fully because he is God. And the whole idea that God is merciful, we start to understand in the Old Testament. There are many places in the Old Testament where God is revealed as merciful. And John Paul II says what he wants to do in this letter is to bring the mystery of divine mercy closer to everyone. Now, doesn't that sound like what Pope Francis has been saying? You know? See, I've noticed that a lot of people today tend to think that Pope Francis is operating totally on his own, that somehow everything that's gone before him doesn't matter. But that's not true. I mean, he's actually, in this year of mercy, I was reading this encyclical and I said, this is Pope Francis. It sounds exactly what he's talking about. Reminding people that God is merciful and bringing the mystery of God's mercy closer to everyone. That's what John Paul wanted to do in 1980. It's actually a mission that the church always has to do because it's what Jesus did. He brings the presence and mercy of God intimately to everyone. And John Paul also wanted to use this encyclical to make an appeal for mercy, first to God. John Paul the Great had a great devotion to the divine mercy, St. Faustina. He was actually important in helping that devotion to be accepted by the Holy Father at the time when he was only a cardinal. And he understood that God's mercy is necessary for humanity. And he also wanted to make an appeal for people to be merciful to one another. And he said that people need mercy even if they don't know it. And that's a very profound insight into the heart of humanity, that people need mercy even if they don't know it. So, in his encyclical, he speaks about mercy as the principal theme in the preaching of Jesus. It's a good idea to read the Gospels, not only to hear it proclaimed at Mass, but to take some time to read a Gospel. You could actually read a Gospel in one sitting, and you'll come to this awareness of Jesus being a preacher of divine mercy. We have the parable of the prodigal son. You know that parable, right? It's the longest reading in the Gospel of Mass ever when it's proclaimed, but it's an awesome parable. The parable of the Good Samaritan, which one of these showed mercy to whoever was wounded. And also he said, by contrast, the parable of a merciless servant. All right, so this servant in the parable, he had a certain debt forgiven by his master, and then this servant went out and bullied one of his other servants and he wouldn't forgive him his debt, and he got in big trouble with his master. The parable of Jesus being the good shepherd who seeks the one lost sheep. And then the parable of the woman who she loses one coin, and she sweeps the whole floor looking for that one coin. And he puts a connection between love and mercy. He actually, in the encyclical, he calls it love mercy. It's kind of like a hyphenated word, love mercy. And this reveals that Jesus demands mercy of others, all right? So when he reveals that God is merciful, he puts a tremendous responsibility on those who hear this. He says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. John Paul II says that mercy is a gospel way of life. So think about that. That if we are Christians, we have to be merciful. We should be known for being merciful to others. If we're known for, you know, belittling people or pushing people around or constantly demanding things of people, we're missing out on the gospel, all right? So being merciful is a gospel way of life. John Paul II goes back to the Old Testament, and he talks about God's people, Israel. God makes a covenant with them, and they break it time and time again. But then they appeal to God's mercy. And this is one of the Old Testament revelations of the mercy of God. Now, people often think that God in the Old Testament was not merciful, and that somehow God in the New Testament is totally different. But that's not true, because the God of the Old Testament is the God of the New Testament, right? And remember, Jesus, he probably knew, actually, of course he did, he knew all the scriptures from the Old Testament, up one side, down the other, right? So he was living in that context. So wasn't Our Lady and the Apostles. In the event of the Exodus, which we usually hear about at the Easter Vigil, we see a manifestation of God's love for his people, where he liberates them from oppression, all right? They're terribly oppressed and not even allowed to worship God, and finally God releases them from all of that. In the Old Testament, there's a passage which says, God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. And this awareness that God is merciful gives the Israelites the strength and the motive to return to the Lord when they have sinned. Now, that actually is important, because sometimes people can believe in God, and they can believe that we have to do his will. They can believe in eternal reward and eternal punishment, but they can fail to believe that God is merciful. Now, if you don't think God is merciful and you've sinned, would you want to turn back to him? You would be like, I just got to stay away. You know, we see this the first time in the Old Testament in the book of Genesis, when Adam and Eve sin, the first thing they do is they hide from God. Somehow their sin has caused them to fail to understand that God is merciful. And it's almost as if down through the ages, there's a constant journey of humanity turning away from God. And so Jesus has to reveal fully that God is merciful, that yes, even though you have sinned, you can turn back to him. Anyway, the Old Testament already reveals that God is merciful. In the Psalms, God is referred to as a God of love, tenderness, mercy, and fidelity. Now, John Paul II, he takes some words out of the Old Testament to talk about the vocabulary of mercy in the Old Testament. And here are some of the words. You don't have to memorize this. There won't be a test, so don't worry. There's a word, hesed, which he says means goodness, which means an interior commitment. And his idea was that, you know, if we have an agreement with one another, there's like an interior agreement based upon the relationship. All right, so it's not simply just we agree to do this or do that, but there's a relationship that exists that becomes the motive for keeping that agreement. And hesed also means fidelity to oneself. All right, so let's suppose I agree to do something for someone. I have to keep that promise to them, but it's also a faithfulness to myself if I keep that promise. Because if I don't, then I'm going to be revealed as like a fraud. You know, Father Jason said he'd do this and he didn't. You know, when if you do that time and time and again, people start to look at you as, oh, this person's not telling the truth, you know. So hesed means like goodness or interior commitment and fidelity to oneself. God in his covenant with the Israelites is manifesting this goodness. Another word in the Old Testament that shows mercy is, now I don't know Hebrew, I don't know how to pronounce it, so I'll probably get it wrong, but it's rahamim, which John Paul said refers to the love that a mother has for her child. You think of like beginning in the womb, all right? So this is describing God, all right, in the Old Testament. Hamal, which means to spare, and hus, which means to have pity or compassion. The Old Testament encourages people to appeal for mercy. and enables them to count on it. That's what John Paul says. The people have this ability to count on God's mercy. Now, John Paul says, he talks about justice, and he says mercy differs from justice, but is not in opposition to it. And there's a passage in Isaiah which says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. The reason why mercy is different from justice, John Paul says, is because of the presence of God who loves. Right? So if God didn't love, then we could think that mercy doesn't matter. It's only justice. But because God reveals that he loves, even loves the sinner, then we have to see that mercy is different from justice, but they're not opposed to it. Because the God who gives the commandments, justice, is the God who loves. And in the midst of all of these signs of God's mercy, Jesus reveals the Father in this, in the midst of all this. He's come to reveal the merciful face of the Father. Then Pope John Paul turns to the New Testament, and he talks about the Gospel of St. Luke, which is often referred to as the Gospel of Mercy. It's the Gospel that has the parable of the prodigal son in it. And it begins by talking about Our Lady, when she receives the news that she's going to have a son who's the Messiah, and then she visits her cousin Elizabeth, and she makes this exclamation called the Magnificat. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his handmaid. And then she says, and from this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him from generation to generation. All right, so there she is proclaiming. Now she knows the Old Testament. She's living the life of the Jewish people. And she says, because of the presence of Christ, that God is merciful from generation to generation. And the Zechariah, who's the father of John the Baptist, he makes a proclamation of God's mercy also. And finally, in the Gospel of St. Luke, we have this prodigal son parable. Now, in this parable, the word justice and the word mercy is not used once. All right, but we have a proclamation of something amazing. John Paul says in the parable of the prodigal son, we have the revelation of mercy as the drama between the father's love and the sin of the father's son, all right, in the parable. So you have the figure of the father who loves his son, but his son has repeatedly sinned against him. And he says the revelation of divine mercy is that drama. It takes place in that parable. The prodigal son wants his inheritance, and his inheritance is a whole bunch of material goods. He wants money. How many of you know want your money? You know, I know someone who says, everybody just wants your money. You know, they're trying to get it. Well, this guy wants his father's money, and that's all he sees as valuable is his inheritance, so he can go off and have a good time. But he has another inheritance that he fails to value, and it's his own interior dignity as a son in his father's house. And because of that, his life turns into a disaster, right? If he had just lived, even if he had left the house, but lived by his dignity as a son of his father, he probably would have made something of himself. He probably would have been very successful. But because he sort of betrayed that interior inheritance, then his life falls apart. The parable reveals what God's mercy is made of. And John Paul goes through the parts of the parable. He says, number one, it shows God as Father. And that, remember in the Old Testament, I said there was a word that meant being faithful to oneself, you know? Well, John Paul says that God is revealed as being faithful to his fatherhood, all right? So his relationship to us as his children is he's being faithful to himself. He is our father. and he's faithful to his love. You see that in the parable. The father is actually, he sees his son coming off in the distance, which means he was probably looking for him, right? And he embraces him and welcomes him back home. So God is revealed as being faithful to his own fatherhood, to his love. And then we come to see that the father comes to see, to behold the goodness of his son's humanity. All right, so remember the son, he's betrayed the father, and he's committed all kinds of sins, but the father seeks the goodness that's still within him, all right, and he sees that goodness. I kind of like the example of, years ago I used to work with a deacon named Deacon John Mannion, who since passed away, and he worked in various situations in the archdiocese, and he told us a story once about, you know when you have a fire, and the fire is about to go out in a fireplace, you have the coals that are there. You see the ashes. But beneath all the ashes, there's still some power of fire there. If you stoke the ashes and put some air, a little more wood, the fire will come back. And he was talking about how this is kind of an example of the sinner. All right, when we think of someone who's committed this or that sin, it could be anything, right? Or even our own sins, we just see their sin. And we're like, boy, this person's no good. Look at what's wrong with them. We might have seen the prodigal son and said, oh, look at him, he's terrible. Look what he did to himself, right? But the father sees what's within. He sees, no, there's still his soul. There's still the fire of goodness in him. And this seeking of his goodness is going to enable the son to go back to his father. Imagine if the father weren't looking for that. If he were just looking to point out how bad his son is, right? The son probably never would have gone back, all right? So there's that passage where the father says, my son was lost and he has been found, all right? What did the father find? He found the goodness of the son's humanity, another manifestation of God's mercy. And finally, this leads to the whole reality of the interior love that God, the father, has for his son, all right? So God knows us better than we know ourselves, and what he knows, he loves. So that's what we see revealed in this parable of the prodigal son. Now, John Paul says that mercy cannot be evaluated exteriorly, that is, on the outside, because the son was only wanting his exterior goods. Mercy has to do with something inside, all right? It has to do with the person, the very heart of the person. Again, doesn't this sound like Pope Francis, you know, talking about the interior life of people and how we have to be close to them in that way? And then finally, John Paul says, love does not allow itself to be conquered by evil, all right? So think of the father being faithful to himself as the father of this prodigal son. And the son has done all kinds of evil. And he could have done some really bad things, right? We don't get the list of everything he's done. They could have been terrible, all right? And they could have been for a long time, too. The father won't allow his love for his son to be defeated by the evil of sin, all right? And Jesus is teaching us that, because people can get to that point where they feel that their sin is so great that even God's love is not for them anymore, right? I once met a young man who was 25 years old, and I was talking to him about God's love for him. And when I told him that God loved him, he started crying. And he said to me that he believed in God, but he said no one ever told him that God loved him, all right? Well, in the parable of the prodigal son, this is revealed. God is revealing to us that he won't allow anyone's sins to defeat his divine love, all right? Okay, and then Pope John Paul the Great moves into what's called the Paschal Mystery, the mystery of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And this gets very interesting. What we see in the life of Jesus is amazing. Jesus was known for going about doing good in healing those who were sick, and also, as the New Testament says, and freeing those who were in the grip of the devil. He was known for doing good. He was known for having never said anything false. In other words, he was a very good man. Then he's betrayed, put on a mock trial, condemned, and he's going to die on the cross. And Jesus now stands in need of mercy. Now, isn't this amazing? All right, here is the Lord himself in a position where he is in need of compassion and mercy. And he doesn't get it. He dies on the cross. All right. Now, John Paul makes the connection with justice. And this is very interesting. He says what's happening when Jesus dies is Jesus is compensating for the sin of many. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So he's taking upon himself kind of like that brokenness that the prodigal son had, but that all of the prodigal sons and daughters down through the ages have brought upon themselves by their own sin. He's taken that upon himself, and in a way, it's like he's making a kind of divine satisfaction for that. He's making up for it. Well, that's kind of like justice, that Jesus is satisfying some kind of divine justice. But by doing this, he's revealing to us mercy. He's revealing to us the mercy that he's going to have for us. He loves us so much that he'll take upon himself the weight of humanity's sins down through the ages in order to rise from the dead and show us the way to heaven. In this context, Pope John Paul mentions that the roots of all evil are fixed in sin and in death. So Jesus takes this on. He takes upon himself the sin of the world. He takes upon himself death. Remember Adam and Eve. The devil tempted them to sin, and that sin led them to experience death. All right. Well, Jesus is going to take that upon himself, and in the resurrection, he's going to show that he's victorious. John Paul makes an interesting statement. He says that in the resurrection, Christ experiences a mercy shown to himself. This is very interesting, because on the cross, it's like he appears as someone who is in need of mercy, and he doesn't get it. He's like the victim in the parable of the Good Samaritan at that moment. He's on the side of the road, half dead. Actually, he dies, right? But then, in the resurrection, he's made new, and death will have no more power over him. So it's almost as if Jesus is taking upon himself the whole drama of humanity, right? The whole drama of, almost like a kind of despair. My God, why have you forsaken me? And the need for compassion and mercy. But then he rises up, right, by the power of his Father. All right, so the next thing that John Paul II does in this letter is he goes to think about the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of Mercy. And let me just read you a little quote from the encyclical here. He talks about this here. He's talking about Mary as the Mother of Mercy. And he says this, that he's talking about Mary and making a sacrifice because she's so intimately united to the suffering death of her son. And John Paul says, her sacrifice is a unique sharing in the revelation of mercy. That is, a sharing in the absolute fidelity of God to his own love. So go back to the Old Testament, that word about being faithful to oneself. All right, so Our Lady shares in this whole mystery of God being faithful to himself in revealing and sharing his divine mercy. And John Paul refers to Mary when she says that she talks about how God's mercy will be from generation to generation. He zeroes in on that, and he says, when Mary said this, this also would have to include not only her generation, but our generation as well. That God will share his mercy to our generation, to the generation after us, the generation before us. And he goes on to now analyze the situation of our generation. Now, this is 1980, and not a whole lot has changed, but then again, a lot has changed. He speaks about how in our generation, we have all kinds of new technology that enables people to communicate across the world. Of course, there was no Facebook back then. There was no Skype and no FaceTime, so we can do this a lot more easily now. He said so many advances in, you know, basically everything we do in life, but he said there was still interior challenges. And he said there was in humanity across the earth a kind of uneasiness about life, that despite all of the advances that were made in the 20th century and a little bit prior to that, there's still some kind of anxiety in humanity. And he starts to talk about them. He says one of them is people today feel under threat. They feel like they're threatened by something. One of them is threatened by self-destruction. All right. You know that song, The Eastern World is Exploding, Violence Flaring and Bullets Loading, or something like that. It was a song in the 60s, right? That's right, Eve of Destruction. There was like this, and then there's also the Doomsday Clock, right, which the atomic scientists always put a little towards midnight. But there's always this sense that, whoa, things could get out of control really fast, and most of the world could be destroyed, or most of humanity could be. He says that we're under the threat of self-destruction. And he said, as we advance in our material abilities, he says there's a kind of materialism that's threatening us. When people value things more than people, all right? And he says this kind of materialism can threaten individuals, the environment, communities, societies, and nations. People can fall victim to the abuse of power by others. This sounds like Pope Francis, doesn't it?
Yes.
Mentions the environment, you know how Pope Francis talks about that. And then he said there's another thing that can happen to people, is people can be placed under a peaceful subjugation, or they can be, in a peaceful way, still oppressed, all right, by others. At his time, he was probably thinking about Poland, but there's things all across the earth he could have been thinking of. He talked about torture as a means of domination and political oppression. In Poland, that was going on a lot. By what was going on there by the Soviets. The other thing he says that is leading to a source of uneasiness among people is, he said, a real sense of remorse. And he starts talking about how, and we know this now in 2016, that he talked about people dying of hunger, all right? Millions of people all across the earth who are hungry and thirsty and dying because of that. And he said that this here can lead to a tremendous remorse among people who are more affluent. You know, how do we solve this? I mean, it's going on even as I give this talk, you know, in other parts of the world. And John Paul was aware that these kind of things create a source of uneasiness, a sense that as advanced as we are, things in this world can be quite precarious. Then he talks about justice. And in the context of justice, he says there can be a problem if you only have justice. Because he said justice could lead people to want to totally annihilate an enemy. All right. Now think for a moment, right now we're thinking on like a global scale, nation versus nation, but think about in your own life. All right. Every one of us at some point has somebody who wrongs us somehow, right? Well, if we are only people of justice, even in our families, right, that can happen among relatives, then it's almost like we could seek to destroy the person. Might not destroy them physically, but we could write them off as people we never speak to, all right? All right, so he said justice alone can lead someone to want to force their enemy into total dependence. And then he's like, wait a minute, where's the equality in that? Right? I mean, justice demands equality, but if I'm constantly oppressing someone who's harmed me, there's no equality there. That's not really justice anymore, because he's still a human being, the person who wronged me. So he said what is necessary is the deeper power of love. Now, go back to the worldwide scale. If we only operate on eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, then eventually it's going to destroy the whole world, right? I mean, who hasn't wronged someone in a little way or a big way in life? He says, if you just operate only by justice, then eventually there is no justice. He says, you need the deeper power of love. And he also points out another problem of uneasiness in the world today, 1980, is a decline in respect for the life of the unborn from conception onward. A decline in respect for marriage and its indissoluble unity, and a decline in the stability of the family. And also a crisis of truth in human relationships. So back in 1980, he was saying there's a crisis in relationships with regard to truth. In other words, people are lying. I've often felt that lying destroys relationships, you know? If you have a friend, you could tolerate a lot of their weaknesses and, you know, negligences or failures, but if they lie to you, you're like, man, I don't want to deal with this person anymore, because maybe all those years that I was invested in this friendship, that somehow it was just fake, you know? So John Paul's talking about how there's a crisis of truth in human relationships, and he also talks about a problem with what he calls utilitarianism. This is this idea, basically, of using people, all right? So if I am a utilitarian person, I only will relate to someone insofar as they can do something for me, all right? So if someone can't help me or advance my career or, you know, make things better for me, I got no use for them, all right? John Paul said in one of his other encyclicals that the opposite of love is not hate. He said the opposite of love is using someone. And don't we understand that in our own lives when we feel that someone's used us? We're like, I don't like this, you know? All right, so he paints this picture of all kinds of trouble in the world. He says the church's mission, that's our mission, is to bear witness to the mercy of God. He says we have to bear witness to the mercy of God by professing it and by incarnating it, all right? So he talks about how do we profess the mercy of God. First, he says, it's professed in the readings in the sacred liturgy. So we got to read the Bible, all right? He says that mercy is often referred to as the greatest attribute of God. And because Jesus is the greatest revelation of God's mercy, we need to contemplate Christ. So we have to be Christians, and we have to really be devoted to the Lord Jesus. We have to meditate on the Word of God. And then he also talks about the Eucharist as a gift of God's mercy. And I need to read something if I can find it. You know how when you want to read something, you can never find it, but when you don't need to read it, it's right in front of you. It happens when everybody's watching you too, you know, you can't find it. So, all right, then he talks about the Eucharist. He says that in the Eucharist, Christ is coming to meet every human heart, all right? So Jesus in his mercy in the Eucharist enters our hearts. So when we go to Mass, whatever's going on in our life, we're opening ourselves to receive this guest of the Father into our hearts, Jesus and his mercy and his love. And then he talks about the sacrament of reconciliation. He says the sacrament of reconciliation prepares the way for each individual to welcome Christ into their heart, even those weighed down with great faults. In this sacrament, each person can experience mercy in a unique way, that is, the love which is more powerful than sin. And he says, no human sin can prevail over the power of God's mercy. All right. He said once near the end of his life in a book he wrote in 2005, or it was published in 2005 before he died, he said that God's mercy was the way of imposing a limit upon evil. All right. So think about evil. Let's suppose we commit some sin and then we realize, boy, I got to turn back to God. So we go to confession and our sin meets up against divine mercy and divine mercy stops it. I mean, it prevents it from taking over our soul, and we're made new in this sacrament. So John Paul was encouraging us back in 1980 to have this great love of the sacrament of reconciliation. And he says that no sin is greater than God's mercy. However, he said, on our part, a lack of goodwill can limit our benefit from God's mercy. So, for example, I use this example when I talk to people about God's mercy. I tell them that I know karate, which I do, so don't try anything, all right? So, brown belt, third degree, in case you're wondering. I could be a Shaolin priest. So, let's suppose during the day, I celebrate Mass, celebrate funerals, I look like a holy person. But at nighttime, I say, you know what? I notice a lot of karate people up and down the streets of Quincy. I'm going to go see how good they are. And I'm going to just start attacking everybody, all right? At nighttime, all right? Maybe I dress in black all the time, so I guess, and I'll dress in white at night or something. But I am not living according to the grace that I receive in the Eucharist at Mass, am I, if I do that, all right? I'm priest by day, you know, violent person by night, all right? So what's happening to me is my lack of goodwill, my lack of conversion and repentance, my opposition to the grace of God's mercy is gonna put a limit on how much God's mercy can do for me. It's like I'm not on the right frequency. God is transmitting to me his mercy, but I'm not listening. All right, so John Paul says, in order to receive God's mercy, all of us need to have conversion. He said conversion has to be part of discovering God's mercy. It's like the prodigal son. He would not have known the mercy of his father if he had not turned away from his sin. He had to turn away, open his heart, and finally experiences the mercy of his father. John Paul says all of us need to have a kind of spirit of constant conversion in our lifetime. Okay, so we've got to profess the mercy of God, and then he says we have to practice it. By the way, I'm coming up near the end of this talk, so I'm coming down the stretch. Short encyclical, so it's a good one. He says we have to practice it, and he says this encyclical is meant to be a call to action, all right? Again, sounds like Pope Francis, right? So Pope Francis is moving in continuity with John Paul II, whom he proclaimed to be a saint, by the way. Jesus Christ taught that man not only receives and experiences the mercy of God, but that he is also called to practice mercy toward others. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Now, that actually is a demand from Jesus. We have to be merciful if we're going to obey Christ. If we're not merciful, we're not obeying Jesus. And John Paul says that Christ is the model of this. As he shows mercy to others, so must we show mercy to others as well. As he shows mercy to us, we have to show mercy to others. And it's kind of interesting that Jesus, when he says, as you've done to the least of my children, you do unto me. So in an interesting way, and this needs to be understood in the context of what Jesus says, that it's like when we're merciful to others, in a way, we're sharing that mercy with Christ. Not that Christ needs to be forgiven of anything. I mean, he's the Lord. But we're participating in his act of divine love. All right? And that's really what heaven is a participation in the love of the Most Holy Trinity. And he goes back to the whole idea of equality, justice, and mercy. He says justice pertains to the good on the outside, all right? So, you know, a fair wage or something, or, you know, the various rights you have in the country. But mercy has to do on the inside. By mercy, we value the person themselves, all right? Think about forgiveness. If I forgive someone of a wrong they've done to me, the first requirement is that they do something wrong to me, right? They've got to lie about me, or they've got to do something, you know, belittle me or bully me around or something. If I forgive them again and again, I'm actually looking deeper into them. I'm not looking at the ashes that surround them. I'm believing that there's a soul there that God loves tremendously. And John Paul says here in this encyclical, he says, mercy is an indispensable element for shaping mutual relationships between people in a spirit of deepest respect for what is human and in a spirit of mutual brotherhood. And he goes on to say that merciful love is supremely indispensable between those who are closest to one another, between husbands and wives, between parents and children, between friends. And it is indispensable in education and also in pastoral work. So in the family, which is the building block of society, we got to be merciful. I like to tell young couples preparing for marriage that they have to know how to forgive each other, you know? Because if we're not merciful, you know, in the family is the first place where we learn to be merciful, right? If you're in a family and you've got siblings, right? Something's gonna go wrong, right? You know? And you gotta learn to forgive. And it's really awesome to see little children forgive each other. Isn't that awesome when, you know, someone, you know, I don't know, bumps into someone or takes something that's theirs and finally they forgive. It's really awesome to see that. Jesus tells us we gotta live like little children in order to get to the kingdom of heaven. Mercy leads to a mutual brotherhood. It helps us to realize that, you know, we're all human beings. We all are in need of mercy from God and from others. Forgiveness goes back to the whole idea that love is more powerful than sin itself. And John Paul, remember I told you how in Poland he experienced the Nazis and the communists? He says the common thread was their failure to respect the dignity of each individual human person. They all had their reasons for that. Well, he said forgiveness is an encounter with the dignity of the person that I forgive. All right? So I'm looking to their goodness. All right, go back to the Old Testament idea of the goodness of the Father. John Paul talks about how Jesus says that we have to forgive 70 times, 7 times. And it's not easy to do that, so we have to pray to God for the grace to be merciful to others. But think about this quote from John Paul. He says, "He who forgives and he who is forgiven encounter one another at an essential point, namely, the dignity or essential value of the person." So that's really a central theme to this whole reality of God's forgiveness. So we have to understand that God reveals himself as merciful, fully in Jesus, that we stand always in need of God's mercy to receive it. We have to be open to conversion. We need to profess the mercy of God. No one through you should think that God is not merciful, all right? Now, mercy doesn't mean that you can keep on sinning. It's not like, well, God is merciful, so we can continue to oppress people and beat people up on the streets of Quincy. No, you can't do that. But mercy means that you're working on the dignity of each individual human person. You know, the thing is that everyone has something going on in their life story that affects them. You know, that young man I told you about who said that no one told him that God loved him. He lived in a family situation that was really difficult. And he was taught about God, but not about God's mercy. And that affected his life. He got into all kinds of trouble in his life. I was the first person to tell him that God loved him. But we need to practice forgiveness because you know something? Jesus says, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." Finally, in this encyclical, John Paul II, he actually offers us quite a, almost like an artistic meditation upon praying to God for mercy. And he makes an appeal to God for mercy because he understood that mercy is the way that God puts a limit upon evil. And I remember what was going on at the time, 1980, with the Cold War. Everybody thought the world was going to end in a big disaster, you know. And the parable of the prodigal son. the mercy of the Father, because the Father is merciful and the Son is aware of that, that is what puts the limit upon the Son's sin. Eventually he converts back to his dignity as a child of the Father. And so we have to profess God's mercy, and we need to practice it. And when we practice it, the world becomes more human. And John Paul tells us that the reason for the existence of the church is to reveal God, that Father who allows us to see him in Christ. So our mission, not only in this year of mercy, it has to be all the time. I'll tell you one funny thing. I was at this convocation of priests for the Archdiocese recently, and one of the priests gave a talk, and he told all the priests, "Now turn to one another and shake the hand of the priest next to you and say, we're all in this together." So after the talk, all the priests were mingling, and we were just kind of saying to each other, "We're all in this together." And I said, "Yeah, only till the end of the year of mercy. Then it's back to the battle," you know? But I was joking, you know? But the year of mercy is meant to encourage us to live Divis Misericordia, God who's rich in mercy. We too have to be rich in mercy as well. Amen. Amen. Okay. If this were a talk on another encyclical, I'd be here for about 5 hours. All right, this was the shortest one he wrote. So, I mean, I don't. If you want to ask some questions, you can, but I don't want to go too long either because I'm a tired priest. Yes?